Tragedy in St. John the Baptist Parish after an early morning shooting leaves two deputies dead, two other deputies injured. Details on what unfolded this morning and the arrest made since.
And the rain is diminishing, but expect more strong storms tomorrow. I'll show you when in my exact cast.
And some runners are trying a new trend, running barefoot. What kind of runner will benefit most from this, and who should avoid it?
This is breaking news from WDSU.
An ambush in St. John the Baptist Parish leaves four deputies shot, two of them killed, and now a community is left to grieve for 34-year-old Brandon Nielsen and 27-year-old Jeremy Trish. Two more deputies were injured. They're identified as 30-year-old Jason Trish and 33-year-old Michael Scott Boyington.
Five suspects are in police custody right now in connection with the shootings.
We have extensive team coverage of the shootings and arrests, as well as updates on the wounded deputies. Plus, reaction from neighbors in the tight-knit community who knew those deputies.
And we begin our coverage with WDSU reporter Gina Swanson. She's live in La Place. And Gina, that's where the sheriff and the colonel made their statements just moments ago.
Absolutely, Camille. The sheriff saying, as you can imagine, it is a difficult day for deputies here in St. John Parish. Sheriff Mike Trigg says that his guys were ambushed as they were simply doing their jobs.
It's been a very difficult day. As you can see, I lost two good officers today.
27-year-old Jeremy Trish and 34-year-old Brandon Nielsen killed in the line of duty as they were investigating an early morning shooting that left two of their colleagues wounded. The shots were fired about 5 Thursday morning. Deputy Michael Boyington was working a traffic detail here at a remote parking lot for the Valero refinery.
As he was working this detail, for some unknown reason at this time, a gunman opened fire on him multiple times.
Trish was also wounded. Police say the shooter sped away, but a tip led officers to the Riverview trailer park nearby. Investigators say deputies were in the process of taking one suspect into custody and questioning two others when the unthinkable happened.
As we were interviewing the two persons, the two subjects, another person exited that trailer with an assault weapon and ambushed by two officers.
As St. John Sheriff Mike Trigg and his deputies come to grips with their loss, state police has taken the lead on the investigation.
Got a very large crime scene here. Multiple locations, multiple weapons, and multiple gunshots.
Troopers canvassed the area on foot and by chopper, looking for additional suspects still on the loose. Police say 5 people have been taken into custody in short order. No word on what charges they face. In the meantime, co-workers and others gathered at River Parish's hospital, where one deputy was being treated for his injuries. The other was taken to University Hospital in New Orleans.
Please pray for the two officers that were ambushed early this morning.
We should mention some of the suspects in this case were injured in the shootout. They are in hospitals across the metro area. Sheriff Mike Trigg says that he did get condolence calls from Governor Bobby Jindal, as well as the head of other law enforcement agencies across the region and across this nation. That's it for now. We're on your side in La Place. I'm Gina Swanson. Back to you.
All right, Gina, and many are reacting to this tragedy. Today, Governor Jindal ordered flags in our state be flown at half staff over the state capitol and all public buildings until sunset tomorrow. Jindal issued this statement. It says, Supriya and I were saddened to hear the news this morning about this terrible act of violence. Our thoughts and prayers are with the victims and their families. The men and women of our law enforcement are heroes who run toward danger, not away from it, so that we can be safe. Scott.
And for the victims, two are recovering from gunshot wounds, and the families of two others are left to grieve. WDSU reporter Sydney Chu and live in La Place with the latest on these victims. Sydney.
Scott, it's been a very hard day for all the families affected. We are learning more about the four men who risked their lives trying to protect this community. Killed in the line of duty today, Deputy Brandon Nielsen and Deputy Jeremy Trish. Nielsen was 34 years old. He had been with the sheriff's office for nearly 2 years as a traffic officer. He had 10 years of law enforcement experience, including stints with the Jefferson Parish Sheriff's Office and Gramercy Police. He leaves behind a wife and 5 kids. Jeremy Trish was 27 years old. He had been with St. John's for 4 years as a canine officer. He's survived by a wife and a two-year-old son. The two other officers recovering from gunshot wounds are Deputy Michael Scott Boyington. He is 33 years old. He had been with the sheriff's office for 3 years and assigned as an investigator with the DA's office. And before that, he was with the Jefferson Parish Sheriff's Office. Deputy Jason Trish is 30 years old. He had 10 years with St. John's working in the Uniform Patrol Division. Now, earlier today, we spoke with the family of Jeremy Trish. He would have been 28 years old on Monday. As we said, he leaves behind a wife and a two-year-old son. He actually grew up in the area where he was killed. His family still lives there. His last conversation with his family early this morning was warning them to stay inside because of trouble in the area.
What's hard is the murder took place about 200 feet behind his mom and dad's house. They heard the gunshots this morning. They heard Jeremy calling for his police dog just before the gunshots. And they have to come home to that.
Jeremy Trish's parents still have not returned home. On your side, live in LaPlace, Simni Chuan, WDSU News.
And one of the deputies, Scott Boyington, was shot in the arm, expected to survive. He was taken to University Hospital. WDSU anchor Sulla Kim continues our team coverage from Mid-City.
It has been just an emotional day for law enforcement community. One of the deputies who was shot was brought here to University Hospital and is being treated. I did get a chance to talk to his best friend who came out of the hospital crying, just really sad and upset about what happened to the deputy, who he says is a devoted father, a devoted husband, and just a really good friend. He's been with the department for more than 10 years. He chose the profession because he wants to help others and just wanted to give back to the community. I've also seen a steady stream of investigators and other law enforcement officials coming out here just to show their support. They say this is a really good time to reflect and thank and appreciate everybody who is in law enforcement, all those who give their lives and sacrifice their lives on duty every single day for the community. Now, the best friend does tell me that the deputy is in good spirits. He says he is positive. He hopes he can make a full recovery. He asks that the community pray for him. On your side, Sulla Kim, WDSU News.
LaPlace is certainly a close-knit community, and many knew the deputies who were wounded or killed. WDSU reporter Blake Hansen continues our team coverage as members of the community grieve.
I just had to jump out on airline and drive a mile.
Chris Clement grew up in LaPlace, and he now works in the family business.
Wrecker, driver, work at the shop.
His job means he works with cops a lot, towing wrecked vehicles, but he never imagined towing what he did this morning.
I got called out this morning to go to River Parish Hospital, pick up one of the units and bring it to True B to be investigated.
When Clement pulled up to Shannon's body shop this afternoon, the impact of this morning's event was visible there too. Erica Robertson also grew up in the area and knew the wife of fallen deputy Jeremy Trish.
She was not a close friend, but I do know her. She's very sweet, just had a little boy.
While residents in this small town want to know why these deputies were shot, Clement knows no reason will make what happened right.
Brings tears to your eyes. I mean, these guys are putting their life on the line every day for, you know, it's horrible.
Putting their lives on the line for citizens now left rattled by this tragedy. On your side in LaPlace, Blake Hansen, WDSU News.
As many people are offering their support to the fallen deputies, the Blood Center is hosting a blood drive tomorrow in their honor and to help the two officers who were injured. It will be held at the St. John Parish Sheriff's Office, that location 1801 West Airline Highway in LaPlace. The blood mobiles will be out at the Sheriff's Office from 11 in the morning until 6 in the evening. Or you can donate blood at the LaPlace Donor Center, which is staying open late tonight. It's located at 123 Beltair Boulevard in LaPlace. You can also donate blood in the officers' names there until 8 p.m. You can get updates on the tragedy in St. Bernard Parish at any time on our website, WDSU.com. And also on the website, you can see images from that scene this morning. While you're there, sign up for breaking news alerts. Also breaking right now, a North Shore student is charged with attempted second-degree murder and second-degree robbery after a fight at Covington High School. Covington police say the fight started at the school and the other teen is in serious condition at Ochsner Hospital. St. Tammany Schools will not release details of that incident because both are juveniles.
And more breaking news to pass along to you right now. The case against an NOPD officer who shot and killed an unarmed man in Gentilly last May was presented to a grand jury this afternoon. He was just indicted with manslaughter. WDSU investigative reporter Travers Mackel live for us right here in the studios at 5 o'clock with the details. Travers,
we actually just got off the phone with multiple sources, and we do hear that this officer, Joshua Kokla, has been indicted for manslaughter. His bond will be set at $300,000. Obviously, manslaughter, a much stiffer penalty than the deal that this officer passed up yesterday. As you know, he turned down a deal for one count of negligent homicide, which would have been a 5-year sentence, but he would have only had to serve 40% of that sentence. The grand jury met throughout the course of today, and we have just gotten up the phone with several sources. They told us the judge, Kiva Landrum Johnson, in this case, moments ago read the indictment officially into the record, and it was in fact manslaughter for this officer, which means he will go to trial and could face, if convicted, a much stiffer sentence if he is convicted. Pano and his attorneys tell us they will give him a full defense. We'll have much more in this developing story as this news is just coming into us.
Travers, thank you for that update and keep us posted. Also today, more rain in our exact cast. Chief Meteorologist Margaret Orr is here with the check on what we can expect tonight.
The good news is that rain is diminishing, but this is what it looked like earlier today. Take it full. You wouldn't believe we had a strong storm develop over by Kenner and then another one in Chalmette where they had street flooding occurring and that water was getting really close to some homes in Araby. Look at those dark skies. But check out what's happening now. The rain is pretty much diminished. Still a few sprinkles in the metro area, some strong storms over by Pascagoula. We can zoom in and you can see this rain now moving to the southeast. It's very light. Had some calls. Can we have our games tonight? Yes, I think you can. But look at this, 324 right there in Chalmette. Quite a few streets were flooding. We can look at those rainfall amounts, and they were anywhere from 1.5 to 2.5 inches. There are those strong storms right now by Pascagoula, but I think we're looking fine for this evening. Not looking fine for tomorrow afternoon and into the weekend. More on that in my next ExactCast.
All right, Mark, thanks. Now to Jefferson Parish and the Aaron Broussard federal corruption case. A businessman has pleaded guilty to bribing the former Jefferson Parish president. 63-year-old William P. Mack pleaded guilty to one count of conspiracy to commit bribery. Court documents show that Mack, the president and owner of First Communications Company, paid Broussard about $1,500 a month in exchange for Broussard steering work in the parish to Mack's company. The amount totaled $66,000. Mack faces 5 years in prison and a $250,000 fine. Sentencing is set for December 6th.
$337 million. That's how much one person has won. How this prize measures up to other Powerball jackpots.
Plus a new fitness trend. You might have seen some people running around town without their shoes on. Is barefoot running right for you? And is it safe? We take a closer look.
And all new for you at 6 o'clock. The battle over who should serve as our state's next Supreme Court Chief Justice was in federal court today. While the governor says the case is not a federal fight.
And the search for the fifth man to break out of Orleans Parish prison in just 4 months continues. Hear how deputies say he did it. That is coming up new at 6.
A new trend in running has some people bearing it all, at least on a certain part of their bodies.
Barefoot running is taking off, but is it right for you? More importantly, is it even safe? Nick Saletti hit the pavement to find out.
Practically my entire life I've been running.
It doesn't get any better than hitting the beach for a nice long run for Mitch Norgaard.
I don't know what I'd do without it.
But as his feet hit the sand, you may notice he's missing a certain something, like, well, a pair of shoes.
It's a great workout, you know, once or twice a week.
No shoes, no problem for Mitch.
It's a great way to strengthen your foot muscles, your calves, your Achilles tendons. And it's a natural way of running. You run more on the balls of your feet than on the heels of your feet.
Sure, barefoot running might work out different parts of your body, but that doesn't mean the practice is for everyone.
Your casual runner, your weekend warrior, somebody who likes to do a 5K twice a year, might not be the best person to jump right into barefoot running because this type of running is very technique dependent.
A technique Dr. Jason Nemitz says can be hard to master. He says you risk a variety of injuries, including stress fractures, if you don't run the right way. But he's not completely against the idea of barefoot running.
People who have good running technique, who are a higher level runner, I think it's okay to switch over.
Mitch coaches runners to ease into it and not go full throttle right off the bat.
People get into barefoot running too quickly and too aggressively. You should build your way into it for sure.
So far, Mitch says he hasn't run into any problems, but of course, he always watches where he steps.
Mitch even says the barefoot running doesn't slow him down. He says you can run just as fast as you can with a pair of running shoes, sometimes even faster.
One lucky person in Michigan is going to be very happy real soon. Lottery officials say someone bought the winning ticket for the estimated $337 million Powerball jackpot at the store you see right there, but has not come forward yet. The pot is just shy of the largest prize to date for the National Lottery, which was $365 million. Powerball is played in 42 states, plus the U.S. Virgin Islands and Washington, D.C.
Well, more rain ahead for the weekend. What's new? Chief Meteorologist Mark Rohr is here to fill us in.
In fact, it's going to be a higher chance of rain than what we've had recently. Hey, we're also watching the tropics. Here is a look at Tropical Storm, you heard me, Gordon. It is the seventh tropical storm of the season, and it's moving really quickly to the east-northeast at 17 miles per hour. It's about 745 miles east-northeast of Bermuda. It's what we call a fish storm, except it's going to get kind of close to Spain. Here is what's happening. You can see it's over warm water, but as it moves to the east-northeast, those water temperatures are going to cool down. It does still have some dry air wrapping into it. Very small system, but some potential it could even become a hurricane. Meanwhile, the remnants of Tropical Depression number 7 now moving into the Bay of Campeche, and some models pick up on it and actually bring it towards the Mexican coast, possibly developing it, and you can see why. Certainly warm waters there, but also some very dry air. The GFS model, which did so well with Debbie, kind of brings it over here towards Mexico. No impact for us because of strong high pressure to the east. Meanwhile, we did have some storms today, but look at how they pretty much diminished. So if you have outdoor activities, not seeing that lightning. Here we are looking at tomorrow, and the main time period is going to be in the afternoon, 3:30. You can see those storms firing up. So when kids are getting out of school, that's when you could have the problems. This is what it looked like from Leslie, that twit pick of that strong storm that developed, particularly over Chalmette, where they did have some of that flooding. In West Wego, Angela sent in this picture. Lockport, they were getting the strong storms too. And in Raceland, Dillon sent it. Look at this shelf cloud. I mean, that's pretty impressive. Temperatures have cooled off because of the rain. 81 now at the airport, 79 at Belle Chasse, and Slidell is 84 degrees. Your overnight lows from the mid to the upper 70s. Closer to the lake, it's the low 80s. And your daytime highs tomorrow more in the low 90s, with that rain chance really going up in the afternoon hours. 12 noon, it's 50%. 3 o'clock, about 50%. But we may end the day at about a 60% chance. For Saturday, it is a 60% chance, and Sunday even higher. What we have are a couple of fronts that are pushing to the south. Thankfully, they'll give the Mississippi River some much needed rain, but there you can see how those fronts drop down. And as we go into next week, the potential that we could have some slightly cooler temperatures, especially in the morning. There is a look at your exact cast with the high rain chances all the way through Monday, and then they kind of back off. And do you see those lows? A little bit lower, the highs a little bit lower. I was at the grocery going, when is the heat going to be over? Well, fall does arrive September 22nd, but that looks better.
Oh, that's close.
Yeah, it's coming
up. Yeah. Thanks, Margaret. An illness is targeting baby boomers, and many don't even know they have it. What experts are doing to find more hepatitis C infections?
Coming up tomorrow at 5, a new fitness trend.
It's a workout program that's not just for Hollywood A-listers. Try C-listers, as in C for Congress. And it crosses the aisle. Details on the Washington workouts.
That looks like it hurts. Stay tuned for NBC Nightly News, and then, of course, WDSU News at 6 o'clock.
In the meantime, get the latest on WDSU.com. We'll see you back here in 33 minutes.